Tracey, who's not talking about Tropical Storm Colin. By the way, WPC did congratulate the modelers on the model's performance with the storm. I guess there's some question about the time. I should talk about that, but the model anticipated the storm well in advance of formation. They know that the GFS and second, we have Tony talking about the weather that was forecast for Sunday. And I'll talk about two points in the GFS.
Okay, thanks, Glenn. Okay, so Tropical Storm Colin is already the third of the Atlantic hurricane season, which is, I think, broke a record, at least in the record books right now. So this is a track of Cyclone Colin. Cyclone Colin formed north of the Yucatan Peninsula and then became a tropical storm status in the Gulf of Mexico, and then moved basically over the northern part of Florida, the Big Bend. And then Colin moved pretty quickly, pretty much right along the coast of South Carolina and North Carolina. And so Colin was a tropical storm from 0Z June 6th to 12Z June 7th. And it was also a pretty weak storm. I think the highest winds were like 50 knots, 45 knots. This is a precipitable water plot in the colors, and it shows the streamlines. And this is the environment before Colin began to develop in the Caribbean and north of the Yucatan Peninsula. So we had convergence here, faster winds, and then weaker winds to the west. So we had a buildup of winds and convergence, and the associated storms that developed. This is from June 3rd. And this is from the 6V June 3rd run. It's an NSEP ensemble-based probability of tropical cyclone genesis. So you can see that really high probabilities. And this is for the five-day period. So really high probabilities, I think about 90% probability. And also pretty good track forecast overall. I think Colin was just a little bit closer to the coast than what this forecasted at the time, but otherwise pretty good forecast. This is from the National Hurricane Center on June 3rd. They started with the medium percent chance of tropical cyclone genesis in 5 days, and then they upgraded to a high percent chance, again, north of the Yucatan Peninsula, and then moving over Florida. So, like I said, the system was named the tropical storm on 0Z June 6th. And this is from 12Z June 6th with the surface analysis. You can see that Colin was west of Florida. And this is a zoomed out map. So this cold front here is actually the same cold front that ends up pushing Colin out to sea and basically gives it no chance of moving up the mid-Atlantic coast or anything like that. So here's Colin, and it was a pretty weak at this time, I think, central pressure of about 1,004 millibars. This is a pretty cool plot. It's from pivotalweather.com. It shows the precipitable water in inches on 12Z June 6th. So Colin is, again, west of Florida. You can see the really high precipitable water values exceeding, even some areas exceeding 2.5 inches. But then these high precipitable water values extended all the way to the north. And the day before was when we had, along the coast, those high precipitable water values, which is kind of that precursor for the severe weather outlook, which Corey will talk about. This is a synoptic setup, the 500 millibar heights and anomalies. And this is, again, 12Z June 6th. Colin was around here. And so you had a broad trough in the northeast and a ridge in the west. You also had another trough in the south central here, and so it was the combination of these two troughs that led Colin basically to the northeast, and then this trough brought it out to sea eventually. We also had a pretty strong jet stream. This is 200 millibar winds, and you can see the really high winds in the southeast, And it was because of these strong winds that the Tropical Storm Colin was sheared on the north and the west side of the storm, which basically caused Colin to be asymmetric with all of its convection on the east side, which I'll show some pictures. This is also the shear and the shear tendencies. So you can see the Colin's right here. You can see the really high values of shear due to those upper-level winds that sheared part of the system. And so this is what Colin looks like on 15B June 6th. Again, all the clouds, precip, and strong winds are concentrated on the east side of this storm. Sorry, where's the center? Yeah, you can kind of make out the circulation here, but everything is focused on the east side. And this is another look at the winds, the surface winds. You can see that really the strongest winds were concentrated on the east side, just to the west of Florida. And I think this image here shows about 40 miles per hour is the highest at the time. And this is from the National Hurricane Center. I just wanted to show the track forecast. I noticed that the cone was pretty small, which is kind of goes with the model agreement for the track forecast. The models were in pretty good agreement overall.
Oh,
that's right. Thanks for pointing that out.
It just looks small because it's zoomed out.
But at the time, Colin was 1,004 millibars and had 50 mile per hour winds as the max. This is from the Weather Prediction Center, the 5-day QPF issued 10Z on June 3rd. And you can see that this was even before Colin formed on June 3rd. So that's a pretty good forecast for heavy rain in Florida. And if we go, you can see that there's virtually no rainfall along the coast here. Then if we go ahead, this is now the 1 to 2 day QPF forecast issued by the Weather Prediction Center. You can see that now they've shifted the heavier rain along the coast of Georgia, South Carolina, and North Carolina. And I think the higher precip was a little bit farther north in Florida. This is just a screenshot of the radar, 16Z June 6th. And then the Storm Prediction Center also put out a slight risk for Florida due to Colin, and even had a 5% tornado probability. And the storm reports, it's hard to see, but there were some wind reports and actually some tornado reports as well. Okay, and then looking at the forecast, this is now valid 12Z, June 7th, this past Tuesday. So at this time, 12Z, June 7th, Colin was just off the coast of South Carolina and North Carolina here, and was about, I think, 1,000 millibars. And you can see the approaching cold front that would eventually push Colin out to sea. This is from the Penn State EWOL, the surface obs. I wanted to focus mainly on the bottom right, which is the observed winds. And I think the scale ends at above 40 here, but there were winds observed greater than 40 knots off the coast here. And so these are the forecasts. This is actually the analysis for 12C June 7th. I have the GFS, the European, the Canadian, and the NavGem. And all the models look pretty similar. They have a similar position. The wind fields are a little bit different. But all of them have the strongest winds focused on the east side of the storm offshore. So starting with the 168-hour forecast, valid 12C the 7th, with the same models. At this time, the models weren't really showing anything quite yet, at least in this grid. I think the GFS and the European did have signs of Colin just further south, outside of the grid. So they were a little bit too slow in the beginning. 144-hour forecast. The European and GFS are showing signs of a low pressure in the Gulf. And then when we get to the 120-hour forecast, that's when all the models pick up on a storm around Florida. The Canadian was too fast and also often too strong with Colin. The GFS and the European were often too slow. And I should mention I put the X here for the actual location at this time. And the nav gem was also too slow. And so you can see that the Canadian has really high winds compared to the other models. And I can't read the central pressure, but it was too strong. 96-hour forecast. The GFS and the European continue to be too slow. The Canadian is way ahead of where it was observed, and still too strong. The nav gem is actually a little bit too fast here. And then the 72-hour forecast. GFS and the European are still a little bit too slow. The GEM model is still too far to the north and east and too quick with the system. The nav gem is too slow. And then 48 hours, now the models are pretty close to the right location here. But maybe still, the European was a little bit too far to the west, a little bit too far inland. GFS is a little bit too far south. And the nav gem also looks to be a little bit too close to the coast compared to verification. And then finally, the 24-hour forecast. The models pretty much agree here on the location and also the wind field, except for the nav gem, which tended to have weaker winds even if it had the same strength of a low, I noticed. And then finally, back to the analysis. And I took a look at the precipitation as well. So this is the five-day accumulated precipitation, the forecast from the GFS and the Canadian model between 12th June 3rd and 12th June 8th, with verification on the right from Weatherbell. And you can see that the GFS was missing all of that heavier precip along the coast. This was a problem with the GFS. The Canadian was showing more rainfall along the Georgia, South Carolina, and North Carolina coast. I noticed that both models were kind of lacking in some of the heavier precip in Florida. The heavier precip extended a little bit further south than what they forecasted. And it also seemed interesting. Dave Novak of WPC mentioned the fact that in some of the runs, the GFS seemed to have a max in the Gulf and then a max in the Atlantic and then a minimum over Florida, which was sort of odd. I noticed in a lot of runs that the GFS and the Canadian were too low in Florida. I thought of that. Yeah, I thought of that. But there is some signs of heavy precip off the coast here.
Is that from Colin or is that from the storm?
Yeah, you could be right. It may not be from Colin. But I think I noticed even in the other forecasts, it was too late with the coastal rain.
Well, that's not in the GFS, just the next slide. It's not uncommon to see rain on each side of Florida, not rain on Florida. I mean, some of the problems we discussed, the topic.
Hey, Glenn, you've shown some cases like that in recent years. I think I had one, too, where it doesn't even have to be a tropical system. The GFS likes to put, again, precip on both sides of the peninsula but leave the actual land drier for some reason. We haven't figured that one out yet.
Well, to say that, you know, with the Cape, the Cape tends to be higher over the ocean. That one is a bit of convection.
The Canadian increase from the previous cycle, it increased the amounts along the coast, and it was actually, I think, too heavy. Okay, so then these are all valid at the same time now, but starting from a different cycle. So once again, the GFS is missing that heavier amount along the southeast coast. The Canadian looks better, but still kind of missing some of that heavier precip in central Florida. And then GFS finally shifted a little bit, the rain a little bit more to the west along the coast. And but was still really just light in most of Florida here compared to the verification. As far as the track goes, the main the main conclusion is that the models were mostly in pretty good agreement. The models were just maybe just a little bit too far to the east with the track instead of closer to the South Carolina, North Carolina coast. For some reason this cycle we only have the H Wharf, but it's a pretty good track forecast overall, maybe just a little bit too far to the east. For this particular run, the Canadian was actually too far inland, and the Canadian was too far inland for a couple other runs, too. So you can see the agreement between all the models. All the models are still maybe just a little bit too far to the east around the South Carolina, North Carolina border. And then in this case, the GFDL was a little bit too far inland. The actual track ended up being maybe somewhere in between the GFS, the H-Wharf, and the GFDL. In this case, you can definitely see that the GFDL ended up being too far inland, or too far to the west. I think Colin ended up, once it was post-tropical, ended up moving pretty close to where the H-Wharf and GFS sit at this time. But then this good agreement pretty much for every cycle. And then the intensities, again, the forecasts were they were pretty good for the most part. The GFDL was a little bit too strong for some runs. The H-Wharf did pretty well with this run. The GFDL was just a little bit too strong. I have the red X's as verification. It's pretty much the same deal. The H-Wharf did pretty well and forecasted slight strengthening. For this next run, the H-Wharf was a little bit too weak, and the GFDL was too strong. The GFDL was forecasting Colin to go down to 972 here, and even in another cycle, it was predicting it to go down to 950, so that never happened. I think the lowest it got was 988, as it was already post-tropical. The GFDL continues to be too strong, and even the H-Wharf was a little bit too strong, but closer to the verification. And this is where the GFDL forecasted down to 955 millibars. H-Wharf looks pretty good for the most part. And then the H-Wharf was a little bit too weak for this cycle. The GFDL continued to be a little bit too strong. So overall, the track errors for Colin, the GFDL had the highest track error forecast, probably because it was too far to the west for some of those runs. The GFS and the H-Wharf were pretty much tied. The intensity errors kind of all over the place here. But the GFDL seems to have the highest, at least compared to the H-Wharf and the GFS. But the GFS had pretty high intensity errors for the 48-hour forecast. And then this is the bias error. So you can see that the GFDL was way too strong for certain forecast lead times. It was also too weak for other lead times. The other models tended to be too weak. And I just thought this was a cool loop. You can see it actually forming, moving over Florida, and then getting kicked out by this upper-level trough that's giving us the pleasant weather right now. And I thought this was kind of a cool plot. This shows Colin, after it became post-tropical, out ahead of this main front that just went through a couple days ago. So then the overall findings, the model hinted at the possibility of tropical cyclone genesis pretty far out. I saw as early as the 0Z29 cycles that they were forecasting tropical cyclone genesis. It was just a matter of where it would go and how strong it would get, and how fast it would be moving.
June 29th.
What did I say?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, May 29th. Yeah. Ahead of myself.
Your predictability.
The Canadian was often too fast and too strong, and the track was too far inland for some of the cycles. The Canadian actually remained too far to the north for other forecasts valid at a different time, even for the 24 to 48-hour forecast. And the GFS and the European started off too slow. The NavGem often forecasted the weakest winds, even when they had pretty much the same strength of the low. compared to other models. Most of the model tracks were pretty good, but sometimes just too far off the coast compared to where Colin moved. There was good agreement overall, and the GFDL at times was too far inland, but actually started off too far off the coast, like some of the other models. The GFDL was often too strong, and the H-warp was at times too weak, but usually closest, at least compared to the GFDL, to the verification. And then for precipitation, the GFS was often missing that coastal rainfall, but then trended closer to the coast. Both the GEM and the GFS seem to be too light in Florida, again with that minimum between two maximums. And they were missing that a heavy rain bullseye that was greater than 5 inches in Florida. And I already went through this stuff, but the GFDL had the highest track errors, had the highest intensity errors. H-warp generally had the lowest intensity errors. And the GFDL tended to have a positive intensity bias, while the other models were often too weak, but closer to verification. And that's all I have. I can take any comments or questions.
Can you go back like 10 times?
10?
Check forecast from model report.
Keep going.
My point is, you know, that
people can't hear you, Jeff, on the phone.
My point is, shows, you know, that the Jeff GL forecast is very west. And the GL, and the H-Wolf and also Jeff GFS also west. But the forecast, the official forecast is very east. So what's in their forecast in mind? They don't use the model data anymore? Yeah, I think you guys want to show that.
Yeah, there's a one official forecast of the ocean river.
Yeah.
Oh, it was really far to the east?
Yeah. Not consistent with models.
Oh, the NHC. Yeah, some of these have the NHC.
Yeah,
that's
probably
why.
And especially near the end of the forecast period, you know, you have to listen to the model.
They use their own model.
There's other models than this that they use. So obviously we had a storm here in an environment that was not favorable for rapid intensification. So why did the GFDL want to rapidly intensify it? Did it miss the shear on the west side?
This definitely isn't the first case where the GFDL was too strong.
Yeah.
Canadian on the west, other town is strong. Canadian doesn't have it, that might all happen. Any other comments? Questions on the line? Do we have any comments?
All right, so I'll be talking about some short-range forecasts of severe weather that happened on the 5th of June. It was associated with shortwave trough moving through. Sort of three parts of this. One will be a HER and parallel HER comparison showing the warm dry bias has been largely mitigated in the parallel HER and some possible influences that that may have had on forecasts of convection. They show a few NAMRR forecasts and move pretty aggressive with some with the convective development. And then finally I'll briefly show SSEO and compare it to the NCAR ensemble. So here are some synoptic maps. These are made by Alicia Bentley from Albany. So within contours here is 300 to 200 millibar potential vorticity. They help to show where the trough is pretty well. And the colored fill is precipitable water, so you can see large amounts to the east of the trough and the southerly flow. And then the red contours are going to be mid-level rising motion, and then the black vector is just irritational wind. And if we move ahead, this is at 12 on the 5th. move ahead 6 hours to 18th on the 5th, you can see this trough starting to become a little more negatively tilted. And then the red contours you see downstream east of it, the rising motion associated with it. In the area of large precipitable water, which is indicative of a lot of the local moisture, which really helped to create instability on this day. The middle of the lapse rates were pretty poor. And then moving ahead to 0Z on the 6th, you see that trough gets even more negatively tilted, and then the rising motion progresses farther and farther eastward. This trough had some extended predictability. These are the convective outlooks issued by SPC. Already at day 5, you can see the highlighted 15% area east of that trough when they anticipated the forcing would be. And then by day 4, they increased probabilities over TC from northern North Carolina up to southeast Pennsylvania to 30%. Then really sort of stuck to the guns, same areas, with an enhanced outlook for day 3 and day 2. And then the associated storm reports are here on the bottom. Looking at day 1, now the storm reports overlaid on the day 1 effective outlook. There's a number of things that are interesting on this day. There's concentrated reports over Wisconsin associated with some organized segments there. Also into North Pennsylvania. But mainly I'll be focusing on this enhanced area. In particular, this gap between the concentrated reports in northern Maryland and southern Pennsylvania, and then down on the North Carolina-Virginia border. So here is the observed reflectivity. This is at 20Z on the 5th of June. What I've circled here is this Boeing segment that produced most of the wind reports in the immediate Maryland and Pennsylvania area. And you can see south of that, there's more scattered cells across North Carolina and South Carolina, which produced maybe some wet microbursts and some wind reports. But the main organized feature was here in Maryland. So this brings me to the HER versus parallel HER comparison. These are four operational HER cycles. This one was initialized at 12Z on the 5th, 11Z, 10Z, and 9Z. And these are all valid at that 20Z fifth time, and then the corresponding observed reflectivity is there on the right. And you can see that the operational HER correctly focused both intense convection on that Maryland-Pennsylvania border. 12Z cycle really good forecast, 9Z cycle as well. Even the other forecasts, cycles had the heaviest and most intense convection in Pennsylvania. If you compare that to the parallel HER, you see the parallel HER was too intense with that scrolling line, bringing it too far to the south into Virginia, just overall a lot hotter with the reflectivity, especially in this 12Z and 10Z cycle. And so I flip between the two, you just focus on any cycle, you see those large differences. So why was the parallel HER so much more aggressive with that convection? The operational HER contained much less instability. This is surface cave here in the fill. Then the parallel HER, and it's especially evident sort of over and downstream of the Appalachian Mountains on the Virginia, West Virginia border. So this is the same four cycles of the operational HER. If you look at the parallel HER, values in the parallel around 1,500 joules per kilogram. Again, if I toggle between the two, the operational HER was around 750 joules per kilogram, so pretty much doubled in stability parallel compared to the operational. If you just look at one cycle, 12Z cycle, the operational HER on the left, parallel HER on the right, I interpolated to some stations for both of these models. And then I have some the corresponding values of temperature and dew point here on the bottom for the operational HER. Parallel HER, and then the observed temperature and dew point values are here in the center. You can see that the operational HER has an 81 over 64 in this red circled area. The observed value was 77 over 70. So you can see that warm dry bias in operational, much too warm, much too dry. Parallel HER improves on that, bringing down the air temperature and increasing the dew point. Then in this yellow circled area, similar story, 86 over 60 in the operational. 79 over 69 observed, so operational much too warm and dry. The parallel improves on that, 81 over 65. Overall, over these four stations, the parallel HER is about 3.5 degrees cooler and 4 degrees moister than the operational HER, and is much closer to what was actually observed. So we are improving on that warm-dry bias, and the parallel HER that will be implemented here in the next few months is a big improvement on that, but it is still slightly warm and dry in observations. And corresponding to that more moist and cool temperatures in the parallel hearth. There's more instability, as I showed. And as that convection moves across the Appalachians, you can see in the parallel hearth, it really intensifies. And so by 19Z, you can see intense convection throughout Virginia in the parallel hearth where there just was none, in the same areas in the operational hearth. And again, as I said, that was consistent with the greater instability in the parallel. So sort of your typical case of maybe right for the wrong reasons, that her warm dry bias seems to have prevented more expansive convective initiation over Virginia that was not prevented in the parallel. If I look at some forecast soundings comparing the operational parallel her taken at this Yellow Star location in northern Maryland, the parallel her is going to be in the red and the operational her is in the blue. This is from the 12Z cycle that I've been looking at. Valid at 12Z, so this is forecast 0-0. They start off very similar, as you would expect. Moving ahead hour by hour, this is at 13Z, again, looking very similar. At 14Z, in the blue, you can see that the surface temperatures start getting too warm, warmer than the parallel herd. Operational herd starts getting warmer. 15Z, that warming continues in the lower levels. And then at 16Z, you can see the operational herd begins also getting drier than the parallel herd. And that warming and drying in the operational compared to the parallel continues. By 19Z, you see a much cooler, moister, and shallower boundary layer in the red here in the parallel herd compared to the operational herd. And we don't know what the exact truth is, since no one went out to northern Maryland and launched a 19Z sounding on this day. But it seems that the parallel herd is doing a better job with capturing the environmental characteristics, given that it was doing much better with surface forecasts. Now bringing in the NAMRR, these are the same four cycles of the NAMRR that I'm showing for the HER 12Z, 11Z, 10Z, and 9Z on the 5th of June. Then the observed reflectivity, composite reflectivity on the right. Generally, I don't think they like looking at composite reflectivity for the NAMRR because it tends to be a little too hot, but overall, this time, it is keying in on this feature in southern Pennsylvania for a lot of these cycles where the most intense convection would be. But it also breaks out too much convection farther south into Virginia and North Carolina. And that becomes more evident looking at later times. So this was 20Z on the 5th of June for a valid time. This is 22Z 2 hours later. And you can see that three of these cycles are really have an intense line moving through DC. Where that was not the case in observations. And then moving towards 1Z, in North Carolina, all of these NAMRR cycles developed an intense squall line in that area that did not occur in observations.
So what's going on there off the, right off the Jersey Shore in the lower right panel?
Talking about that
sort of wavelength. Yeah, that's a very odd reflectivity field.
The visiting Penn State students observe similar things, I guess, in high-res model runs they're looking at for the NAM fire weather nest and the NAM nest, so maybe similar type thing going on for these.
I guess it's in the upper right corner as well.
Yeah, so they're trying to check down if that's gravity wave things or maybe some numerical type instability, so it could be a similar thing going on here. At any rate, comparing the NAMRR to these are those HER X cycles, you see the HER doesn't develop that squall line in North Carolina, but the NAMRR does, so the HER looks a lot better in that regard. So sort of three tiers here. The parallel HER is sort of the middle. Operational HER didn't develop as much convection correctly. Parallel HER was a little more aggressive with convection than NAMRR seems to be the most aggressive with the convection. Just to get an idea of why the NAMRR may have more convection, here's instability on the top, surface cape, and then few points on the bottom, NAMRR on the left, parallel HER on the right. You can see greater instability here. This is a 20Z valid time in the NAMRR compared to the parallel HER, and then looking at dew point, it's hard to tell with the reds here, but NAMRR is a little higher with the dew points. It's more obvious further to the west over Ohio and Pennsylvania as an MRR has higher dew points than the parallel HER. You see the greater instability in that area as well. Yeah, it's another thing that we've noticed a lot is that an MRR seems to really drop the dew points significantly in the cold pools that you don't see in the HER, or really other NMNB models as well. The high-res NM window, that's the NMNB flavor, doesn't have as cold pools as well. So it's probably more of a microphysics thing going on in the MRR. And then looking at QPS, this is something that really I've been bringing up every time I present lately, but the MRR has more concentrated, higher values compared to the HER or stage 4 observations. The HER and stage 4 seems to have more moderate, spread out areas, whereas an MRR has more concentrated corridors of QPF values, and in between you have these lighter amounts. So not as spread out and moderate or an area as it should be, if that makes sense. So briefly looking at some ensemble forecasts, this is the 0Z5 SSEO, valid at 21Z on the 5th, and this is updraft helicity in excess of 25, I think is the value here. As you can see, this is at the 21Z. Moving ahead to 0Z, you can see that the SSEO is implying there's going to be some severe weather from Pennsylvania as North Carolina. There is a relative minimum in the DC area, but not as wide as the gap that there was in the reports, and the lack of severe pretty much over all of Virginia that actually occurred. And then as storms are winding down here at 3Z, you see the UH signatures decrease as well. Moving ahead to the 12Z, SIF SSEO. This is, I think, is an extremely good forecast sort of ensemble sort of help for a forecaster, showing these two distinct areas, one in southern Virginia and one along the Maryland and Pennsylvania border. This will be a slight reflection of the Ohio severe, but really none of them melted too well with that aspect of this. But moving ahead to 0Z on the 6th, again, you're seeing those two areas highlighted here in the SSEO, and then winding down at 2Z. Looking at the NCAR ensemble, this is from 0Z fifth cycle. This is UH greater than 50 meters squared per second squared. And here you see, again, an unbroken line of UH tracks, so you're not getting that gap between them. And again, at the 0Z, fifth SSEO initialization, you also didn't really have that gap in the UH track. So it seemed to be sort of a more smaller scale feature that required shorter lead time to really pick up on that there would be this gap between southern Virginia and Pennsylvania severe weather. So that was one of the greatest forecast challenges on this day, I think. Looking at sort of the accumulated UH tracks, again, in excess of 50 meters squared per second squared, in the first 24 hours of the NCAR ensemble, again, you're not seeing, like that's a CO, a reflection of the Ohio and Pennsylvania severe weather, at least looking at this parameter, and you're getting sort of an expansive area of UH tracks all across Virginia. But you do see the highest values in southern Pennsylvania, corresponding to where the severe MCS went through. So maybe some predictability to that event, even first cycles initialized at 0Z on the 5th. And so in summary, this event had extended predictability with regard to the shortwave trough. The extent of storm coverage was uncertain with a large gap in Virginia where there was an enhanced risk issued. The parallel HER certainly captures environmental conditions better than the HER, but at least in this case, that didn't really translate to a better convective forecast where HER really curbed the development over Virginia because it was too warm and too dry. The MRR seemed to be a little more aggressive than the parallel HER here. And then the SSEO showed a lot of utility, I think, in identifying favorable areas of severe convection, and that's a 12Z with initialization. So with that, I'll take any comments or questions.
Questions, comments.
I noticed that once again the GFS dropped a lot of QPS in the Chesapeake Bay during this case. So again, I was like on both sides of the peninsula.
No, I didn't. So what was that?
the GFS drops a lot of QPS in the Chesapeake Bay.
Okay, so over the water and not on land. Right. Seems...
I guess probably similar to last week what we looked at with over the colder Great Lakes that wanted to dump over those.
What are the fuck issues?
Any comments on the line, questions?
Hey, this is Steve Zubrick at Sterling. I don't know if STC is on, if anyone was from on. From there, but two comments. One, sometimes the AWOS sites that may get ingested into the model analysis, dew points like in Louisa County and Fredericksburg, those I noticed were 2 to 3 to 4 degrees Fahrenheit too high compared to our what I consider good ASOS readings that we take. The second point is that Bill Bunting and Steve Weiss sent me a verification graph. You showed one graph for their day one outlook with the actual plots of the reports, but they also, you know, they go in and they verify the various category thresholds, and so they had like a 30% risk area in there. And when you look at their statistics, and Corey and Jeff, I actually sent you this figure that I'm about to discuss. The 30% area that they had drawn in the day one outlook for both 13Z and the update at 1630Z, it actually underperformed for the number of reports that were contained in the grid verification boxes for those outlooks. So there was some comments, you know, like in the Capital Weather Gang saying that, gee, you know, we were talking about a big event on Sunday, and it underperformed. But when you look at the uncertainty of this and look at what the 30% chance means, it actually, we were under forecasting the severe threat based on that 30% probability. I think communication-wise, most people were thinking, since it didn't hit D.C., you know, then it was a bust, you know, for an enhanced outlook. But, you know, for the folks in other areas within that enhanced outlook in the mid-Atlantic states, it actually performed pretty well, and, in fact, it underperformed. And that's according to this scheme that SBC came up with Ariel Cohen. I don't know if SBC's on the line if they want to comment on that.
Yeah, I'd like so to know. What was the probability contour, the practically perfect, that verified?
The 30%. I could go down to Steve Weiss, and they have these for all of the outlooks. It's that, like, this was for the wind probability outlook verification. So I think that they do a verification for the wind, for the hail, and the tornado.
But what I'm saying is, did it actually verify as a 50 or 60 or as a 15? I guess I'm not sure what you mean by underperform.
I think it actually verified. It was... The bias on it was it was actually like 40% coverage.
Right. So it
had a bias of like minus 10.
Yeah, the forecast was fine. In other words, it was not a bust.
From a public perception, if you weight the population of the enhanced area and what they saw, you know, for people in the major metropolitan areas like D.C., it was nothing really happened there. It rained a little bit, and that was it. So from our perspective as scientists, it actually did reasonably well, and, in fact, it was a little underdone. So for the enhanced area, there was no moderate risk that was out there. So I don't think it would have, you know, verified a moderate. But it did fine for the enhanced. But the perception that we have in communicating that to the users, to the media partners, that's a challenge, because they had this outlook area, you know, was over the mid-Atlantic states for days and days, going back to like day 5 or even day 6. So there was kind of a perception that was being portrayed, you know, by the SBC that there was a threat, and the media picked up on it, and they did their usual spin and hype on it, and so they kind of had everybody worked up to expect that something was going to happen bad on Sunday, even though in the articles and in their presentations on broadcast, they said that there's still uncertainty. Everyone kind of forgot that and just looked at the enhanced area and said, oh my, you know. So there were things that were canceled. There was a big fair that was canceled that day in Montgomery County, Maryland. So.
But if you were in Philadelphia, do you feel the same?
In Philadelphia, you feel great. And I know Walt Draggett, the Mount Holly office, you know, said that, gave feedback to SBC saying that they did a good job on this. And people even up towards New York City, they appreciated having that enhanced area, and as well as I think the folks down to the south along the Virginia-North Carolina border. It's just that we happen to be in a hole here in that 30% area. But that was well within the uncertainty that was being played out in all of the models.
Thanks, Steve. We need to get to our last speaker, so thank you for your comments.
Sounds like the New York City blizzard of 2015, when people criticized us because we didn't hit New York City when we did hit New England pretty well.
Okay.
We talked about certainly the first two of these problems last week, so I'm not going to say much here. I'm going to have more to say about the first two at 110 and the Global Branch meeting. Going to talk some about dew points over the northern Great Plains, and Banglin has created another parallel to test some convection changes developed by John Jill. That's hopefully will make help us make some progress here. This is a comment Banglin received from NetCheck in the UK after the implementation. The GFS is often showing rain developing across much of the UK when it stays dry. We anticipated an increase, a 3 to 4% increase in the bias. This is from 2 years of testing, the GFS implemented in May, and there's a 3 to 4% increase in the bias for essentially drizzle rain, no rain. However, it seems like the forecasters are noticing the fastest increase is concentrated in certain areas. This is over the Conus as a whole. And this was TJ. TJ sent this message out a couple of weeks ago, problems with GFS over their water for the Great Lake. This truck seemed to be struggling with the lake-land interface. Seems to be more along the coastline. And Mark Klein of WPC confirmed this via noticed some very strong moisture gradients, and actually dew points might be too low over the lake. This is a particular case he sent. This is the Great Lakes. You can see right along the coast here, we have these maximum in precip that did not verify, also here over Lake Superior and along here, you can see. And other models did not have this feature. Someone from La Crosse, Wisconsin forecast offices noted trouble with the dew point. Most of the models had a positive bias. The GFS has a 10-degree Fahrenheit bias over a 7-day period. Afternoons was the worst. And this is his actual graph. The various models are shown here. Forecast hours is horizontal. You can see the GFS routinely has like a 10-degree bias or so, averaged over these 7 days through high dew points in Wisconsin. And other forecasters noticed this. One forecaster at Grand Rapids looked into this, found that took a sounding over the lake when precip was forecast, had a cape of 2,200 MU cape, and dew point increased. And again, it seems to occur when there is surface wind convergence at the land-lake interface. Okay. In Goodland, Kansas, they actually had a negative bias. This is further south. This high dew point is more over the Great Lakes. There's some three sites online. There's comparisons of near surface fields to station observations, and also Tracy's radio sound site. This is a sounding for Green Bay. This is a 12-hour forecast DAST. versus the observed sounding. You can see a little bit cool at this near the surface, and the GFS 12-hour forecast is 0Z. You can notice a definite wet bias here in the near, in the boundary layer. This is what we found. This is Fang Lin did this plot over the three summer months for all four sites from 0 to 24 hours, the new minus the old. You can see the dew point we've increased by 1 to 2 degrees, and it's really over the, you know, over the Great Plains, but more so over the northern Great Plains than the south. This is a difference from the European, us minus the European center, and let's see, this is at 0Z only. You can see we are 2 to 4 degrees higher dew point here in the F00, and almost the same here at 120 hours. And we tend to have cooler temperatures over the east, not so much out at F00, not so much at 5 days. The European center is just a comparison, it's not the truth, but I think the impression we have was they did have less bias in the near surface parameters than we do. I think Fang Lin pointed that out a few years ago. This is from the test. This is over the northern plains in the Midwest over about 2 years, and this is as a function of forecast office. This is from 0Z, so you see the donor cycle. Black is the station, red is the old GFS, and green is the new. And you can see we've shifted the whole donor cycle up. Here we used to have a cool bias here. Now it's pretty good, but now around here, about 96, we've moved from about no bias up to a, now we have a wet bias of about a degree over the whole, this is over the whole annual cycle. So you can see we simply shifted it from a dry bias to a wet bias at a different time of day. This is now a plot for 0Z 96-hour forecast, so it's all for the same time of day over the 2 years. And you can see in the summer, in the fall, red is the old, blue is what we have now. In the summer and fall, in both times, we've reduced a dry bias. But notice what we did in the late spring, early summer. We had a too high dew point, a wet bias, and we increased it by about a degree. Same time, same thing in 2015. Okay, so that's 0Z. I have the other three times of the day, 6Z, very little bias, you can see. You know, it's generally a cool bias. I think we generally improved it at 6Z, reduced the cool bias. Same at 12Z, but little bias. 18Z, you can see here now, there's some sign here. This is only over 1 year. In the late winter, early springs, we did have here a bit of a bias, and we increased that. This is now the operational GFS, and this is over the last year. You can see early last summer, we had a high bias in the dew point. Then we went dry, continued, and then we went wet again. You notice a jump here in May, and I've just continuity there, and higher values by 1 to 2 degrees. And that is when we went to the new GFS. So introducing the new GFS increased the bias by at least a degree. And that's what we expect, a degree increase from our test. Over the southern plains, this is the observed in black. And again, this is over 2 years from 0Z. And you can see what we did here. We were way too dry before in the old model, and we improved on it, and we're still too dry in the southern plains. So this is a northern plains problem. And this is just, you can see 0Z. You know, we've raised it as the spring, as some evidence of some wet bias in the spring and so on, but not as much. And at 0Z, you can see, if anything, the bias has gone down since we implemented the new model. So, okay. So, increase in the solstice rain anticipated, but the forecasts are noticing it more than you would think if it's 3 to 4% everywhere. Chance perhaps it increases. The 3 to 4% is more localized. Maybe the increase is more localized than we thought. Times GFS forecasts more precipitate over the Great Lakes, and it's enhanced near the coast. Not clear why. The air is too saturated. We have apparently too easy a convection trigger. And then there's a lake breeze effect that comes in. That's why it develops near the coast. GFS has two high dew points at zero Z over the northern Great Plains in late spring. Bias was increased in the new model. We anticipated this. It was there in our statistics, whether we advertised it or not. Perhaps the weather regime has enhanced it a bit. What does this have? Now, this doesn't happen every time. I have other examples when the GFS agreed well with others. This is a dew point, actually, the initial dew point, June 7th at 0Z. European Center here, GFS here. You can see how we have wet conditions, humid conditions extend further into the Midwest, and this is the difference. And this is 10 to 15 degrees higher dew points in this region. If you compare us to the NAM, and now NAM minus the GFS, you can see NAM has, put about 10 to 15 degrees lower dew points than GFS. And if you use the RAP, as Mannequin urges, as of the tiebreaker, you can see, if anything, the NAM dew points are higher. So we have two high dew points there. This is a sounding for Lincoln in the middle of that area. And you can see it's much moisture by several degrees here in the boundary layer and cooler in temperature.
So that comes back to since that was F00, here's your 12-hour forecast.
Yeah.
Your 12-hour forecast is too moist in the low levels. By not drawing for surface data at the analysis time, there's no way to correct that.
And even, if we drew for surface data, it might not fix all the problems.
That wouldn't fix, certainly wouldn't, but.
The 12-hour forecast, what's the validation time?
This is at 0Z. This is the 12-hour forecast from 12Z for 0Z.
So your forecast valid at 0Z are too moist, and you don't draw off or any surface data at 0Z to correct that.
We talked about it on previous meetings.
Yeah.
We have a 0Z cold bias and wet bias, and that can be fixed later.
Okay.
We have the code to fix that.
This is the Cape difference between the NAM and the GFS. You can see the NAM we have this high Cape here over Nebraska, where the NAM is much lower. Okay. And again, the NAM is slightly higher than the RAP, so the GFS is the outlier. Okay, and this is some work by John Jill. Fanglin has started up a new NAM parallel tie. And with the new deep convection system turned on. I believe this is harder to trigger, makes the convection a bit harder to trigger. Please correct me if I'm wrong. And there seems to be a reduction in popcorn precip from earlier tests. And this is a recent talk given by John Gilham in co-authors, some here and some in Korea with one of our old colleagues. And I'm not going to try to attempt to explain all the details in 5 minutes. And I don't know if I could do it in 15. I might ask. See if we can evolve the invitation. Okay. This is a medium range forecast that has been done. 1534, then Lagrange and operational. Okay. And we have 7-day forecast, each 0-0 cycle over 4 months. No data assimilation. So he compares the GFS in black, the old GFS, the current GFS is in red, and the green is the current plus the new convection. And you can see the continental U.S. precipitation forecast. This is 12-1-day forecast. You can see significant improvement in threat scores and a decrease in bias, even below the old model. Same at 2 days, although the significant might be a bit not so clear, and a reduction in bias in up to 3 days. Looks like what? Okay. And so we're testing the convex changes to convection to reduce the popcorn precip source of strain and improve the precipitation skill. I did see one or two forecasts that seem to have less rainfall over the Great Lakes, but it's much too soon. And I think Fanlin said he might have had an error in those first 2 days.
Is the popcorn precip convective or stratiform or both?
Yes. I think it's convective in the summer and I think stratiform in the winter.
Okay. Yeah, great.
So.
Yeah, I noticed a couple of runs ago, GFS had like 10 inches of rain in the next 2 weeks just northeast of Chicago, maybe about centered 5 or 10 miles offshore, but it's since backed off a little, but it was an interesting crescent moon shape to the precip max that was parallel to the coast. So it is an interesting feature, no doubt.
Yep. And then these are things we're considering for the next GFS next year, the new modeling structure. And we're testing the convection changes. I believe land surface changes are being tested as well. And NSSD, which is a better way of defining the sea surface temperature.
Okay. This is Andy from Western Region. Is there any insight into why the wet bias seems to be more pronounced over the Midwest than the southern U.S.?
I think there's something in the regime, Andy. I mean, I haven't looked at the soil moisture. I'm assuming it's wet up there because every model is running high with the dew points up there. I think last night's zero Z NAM, like I think it was at day three, had low 80s dew points over Wisconsin. So they're all running wet up there. So we're sensitive to something. I'm assuming soil moisture, but I haven't looked.
Northern Great Plains should have snow in the winter. The southern's probably less likely. Is that a contributing factor?
Yeah, but over the last 2-3 months, there hasn't been much in the way of snow in the Midwest.
Yeah. Problem starts in late spring after I think most of the snow will be gone.
Well, at least we can adjust the bias between the, like, for example, today the HER mixes the dew points in eastern Kansas into the 40s and even upper 30s. So if we just we can use the GFS and NAM to bias correct that. It's kind of a dumb joke, sorry. But it is interesting to see what happens with that.
Jeff, how is the soil moisture running up there? Has it been very wet?
Well, it was very wet until about 10 days ago, and then it just basically stopped raining in this general area.
I suspect we have some very wet soil there. We'll look at that.
Okay, any other comments, questions? Okay, thank you all.